Now we're in Genesis chapter 27. We're at verse, 21. 20 was that excellent trick that Jacob gave to his father Isaac, "The Lord thy God brought it to me." What a pious thing to say. Verse 21, "And Isaac said unto Jacob, Come near, I pray thee, that I may feel thee, my son." So Isaac is saying to Jacob, come near me, and I ask you. So pray is another word for beseech or requesting or asking. I'm praying you, and for those of you who are saying, oh, what's thee? It's so hard to understand. What is thee? What is thee? I don't like the thees and thous in the scripture, and oh, I don't understand. I guarantee 90% of you already know what thee is. Why bother telling you what it is? These critics, they say, these and thous are so hard to understand. You might as well say you. It's easier that way. You already defined what these and thous were.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're just lying. You just don't like the these and thou. That's why. All right, anyways. So he says, so that I can feel you, my son. He wants to feel him because whether thou be my very son Esau or not, so that I can see if you are truly my son Esau or not. So Isaac's doubting again. And Jacob went near unto Isaac his father, and he felt him. So Jacob, he went near to Isaac his father, and Isaac felt him, trying to feel him out. Now notice most of this is self-explanatory, so it's not really hard to understand the archaic English in your King James Bible. So if you think that I'm just being very redundant, well, the reason why I'm doing that is so that the goal of this verse-by-verse Bible study is so that you can understand every single word in the verse, okay? Granted, there are some things that are hard to understand, but no matter how much you update the Bible, when you study God's words, there's going to be something hard that you're not going to understand, no matter how much you update that book. Because we're talking about God's words right here. Another thing, why dare simplify what God wants to say?
Right.
Why dumb down? You know, why not just leave his words as it is? Anyways, continuing on. And said, the voice is Jacob's voice, but the hands are the hands of Esau. So Isaac, after he feels Jacob, he says, you know, it's Jacob's voice, but these hands, they feel like Esau's hands. Verse 23, and he discerned him not because his hands were hairy as his brother Esau's hands. So he blessed him. So Isaac couldn't tell. He doesn't have that discernment. He couldn't distinguish. He couldn't tell if it was Esau or not because the hands were very hairy. So probably Isaac is thinking that I'm just dying. I'm getting really old or something. So he assumed that the hairy hands, they were like Esau's hands. They felt like Esau's hands. So he decided to bless him. Verse 24, he doubts again. You know, Seth, Isaac is not sure. And he said, art thou my very son Esau? So he says to Jacob, are you really my son Esau? That's what very means. So very is like really, truly, certainly. And he said, I am. So Jacob lies, I am. And he said, bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison, that my soul may bless thee. So Isaac says, bring that venison close to me so that I can eat from your venison. So remember, that's deer meat that he's making. And then that way his soul... So remember, soul is referring to his own personality. The real him can bless Jacob. And he brought it near to him, and he did eat. And he brought him wine, and he drank. So Jacob brought the deer meat close to Isaac, and then Isaac ate from it. And Jacob brought Isaac grape juice, and then Isaac drank from that grape juice. So wine in your Bible is not referring to alcoholic wine, for some people who don't know.
Right.
That's referring to grape juice. Now, we know that this is the case because it was common during that time for people to drink grape juice. For a bunch of critics and comments, who says, it wasn't common that time in the Bible for people to drink grape juice. That's unheard of. These people, if they are those drunken Calvinists like I suspect, or worldly people or Christians who want to keep their sin, whoever you are watching, it was common that time to drink grape juice. I'm not going to really expound on this passage because I want to cover the other verses. Wine is not the issue here. The issue is about Jacob and Isaac.
Right.
But in that same book in Genesis, Jacob, who gave Isaac the wine, talked about grapes. And he put wine in connection with blood of grapes or juice of grapes. If you look at Pharaoh, when they celebrated his birthday, they squeezed the grapes into the cup and he drank. Now, don't tell me it wasn't common for people, especially royalty, to drink grape juice. You don't know what you're talking about. Fool.
Amen.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, anyways, let's look at verse 26. And his father Isaac said unto him, come near now and kiss me, my son. So Jacob's father Isaac says to him, I want you to come near me this time, and I want you to kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his raiment and blessed him. So Jacob came near him, Isaac kissed him, and then Isaac, he immediately smelled Jacob's clothing, his raiment. Why? Because he's doubting again. He wants to really see if it's Esau. And then he decided to bless him after smelling him. He says, see, the smell of my son is as the smell of a field which the Lord hath blessed. So Isaac's trying to assure himself. Look at this, see, my son's smell is truly Esau's smell when he goes out in the field, and that's what it smells like. And it's as the field that the Lord has blessed. So that statement sounds like he's about to start the blessing, okay? So basically, it's like a transition from, 27 to 28. So then 27, even though he's saying, he's assuring himself that this is Esau's smell, at the same time in that very same speech, he's starting the blessing. So he's transitioning. As he's transitioning that, well, okay, so this is Esau's smell, and he smells like the field that the Lord has blessed. So now let nations serve you, God's blessing fall upon you. So that's what's happening at the next verse, okay? So I kind of gave the context of that. Verse 28, therefore God give thee of the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. So Isaac says, that's why, because the field that God has blessed, I want God, as a result, to give you the dew of heaven. So the rain from the sky. That way he can have plentiful crop. He can have plentiful planting. The fatness of the earth. So that's all the richness inside the earth. So whatever the earth has in its own ground to bestow it upon Jacob. And that he would get a lot of corn and wine. Now that's proof that the Mandela effect is very real. Now why are you laughing, brother? It's real. So the Mandela effect is very real because corn obviously did not exist in the book of Genesis. So there were changes going on in your King James Bible. Now some of you watching me are probably saying amen because you think I'm serious. No, I'm joking.
Yeah, amen.
Okay. Now, obviously, that's not a mistake in your King James Bible. That's just the lack of knowledge that people lack total discernment nowadays because now we got dimwits growing up in an online generation.
Yep.
If you are upset with me, then look at your child playing with his or her cell phone and being on technology all day long before you get upset with me. All right, we're in a dimwit generation of whatever pops up online you believe, okay? So what's going on online is they're saying that criticism that I mentioned before, that corn never existed in the book of Genesis until many years later. So that's an error in the King James Bible. Well, what So they were dabbling with time, and then somehow the memories that we had back in the past, they changed it, or they switched it. Because back then, it should be grain and wine, but not corn and wine. So someone recent must have dabbled with it, where it used to be grain and wine, but then they dabbled with it. Somehow they dabbled with time, and then they changed it to corn. Now, one, that's the most idiotic conspiracy that I ever heard, because if you really want to fool people by changing grain to corn, I think that's a really stupid thing to do.
Yeah.
All right? If I want to start a conspiracy and dabble time, I know what I would do. Rather than just put corn and wine, come on, bro. Really? Really? Man? My goodness, man. Justifying crack maybe and alcohol, if they assume wine is a definition of alcohol. Maybe that you could use this to justify drugs, I don't know. But anyways, corn right here, it's based off of Old English, right? The King James Bible. If you know your etymology, if you know your history, English came from Saxon, and literally, it's corn, okay? But it's with a K, K-O-R-N. And that Saxon word, corn, is for grain, actually. Oh, surprise. Okay, anyways. Verse 28, Isaac is bestowing the blessing on Jacob that he would have lots of basically plantation, vegetation. That's the idea. And the fruits of it. That's why he says corn and wine. Verse 29, let people serve thee and nations bow down to thee. Be Lord over thy brethren. So Isaac says, let people around you serve you, nations. Now, I know that people hate that, but yes, the nation of Israel is God's chosen nation. Israel is another word for Jacob, for some of you who didn't know. Israel is Jacob's alternative name. So nations around the world, they're going to serve. They're going to bow down to the nation of Israel. The nation of Israel, as I've told you many times, it's in a state of wickedness, and the devil is using it. That's why he wants to take over the nation of Israel, and he is. But God's going to restore the nation of Israel and get it back to him sometime in the future. So this blessing is not in fulfillment yet. And then Jacob, Isaac says, is going to be Lord over his own brethren. And let thy mother's sons bow down to thee. So all of Jacob's mother's children, they're going to submit to him, bow down to him. Cursed be everyone that curseth thee, and blessed be he that blesseth thee. Isaac says, anyone who curse you, let the curse fall on them. Anyone who bless you, let them receive a blessing in return. So notice this is undoubtedly the Abrahamic blessing that's repeated at Genesis chapter 12, right? So we've seen that at Genesis chapter 12. It's repeated again. Jacob now inherits the Abrahamic blessing. Several things to note here as we go back. Okay, now that I read the whole context, let's go back here. I know it was a little bit corny maybe for me to do 27, 28 to explain to you that transition of Isaac, but there's a expository sermon there for some of you who didn't see that. So let me go back and repeat something. Isaac, from his tent here, as he's resting and then enjoying the deer meat, he says, when he was doubting, notice that he's blessed, that he's confirming his doubt based on, this was his problem, remember? Remember the second generation Christian? What's your problem? It's a fleshly thing, right? And it's not big, it's small, right? It's a fleshly issue. Let me know when I'm too high, okay? I'm going to go higher than this, okay?
That's about it, honestly.
I see. Okay, thank you. So let's erase this. It was a joke. Okay. So with his fleshly issue, Isaac, who pictures that second generation Christian, he is basing everything off of a small thing because it's not a big deal. He's mostly spiritual.
And we've seen that, not as much as the first generation, but he's pretty good overall, and the fleshly issue is not that bad. He just likes what he tastes. Okay, now remember, his God is his belly. That was his problem, right? It was the food. That's why he liked Esau. Now it came back to haunt him. There's a huge repercussion that results from that. Based off of a fleshly issue called taste, sin naturally grows. Now his other fleshly senses are kicking in. So notice I mentioned confirming the doubt. If I said that, sorry. I mean, he's trying to confirm his assurance and erase his doubt by basing off his fleshly sense. So by touching him, because touching is almost like tasting. The sensation of it, the fulfillment of the flesh. So then by touching him, he says, it feels like Esau. So then from the fleshly issue, it grew now to more of the similar fleshly issues. More and similar. Now, those two have a lot of meaning there that you can make probably a one-hour message on, just based off one fleshly issue. More things can happen that will be similar to it. They're always related. They're always related. Now, what happens is his doubt is his safe factor, believe it or not. Go to Romans 14. Romans 14. Notice that this verse pictures, perfectly matches with Isaac. It's too bad. Isaac is one of the greats in our Bible that we read about. And his fleshly issue is very small, but it's very sad. Out of every single person that you can think of in this verse, if I were to ask you to name me this one person who would fit well in Romans 14:23, the first person on your mind for many of you would be Isaac. Go to Romans 14:23. And he that doubteth is damned if he eat, because he eateth not of faith, for whatsoever is not of faith is sin. Yep. I mean, Cain's not going to pop out in your mind, or Judas Iscariot here. Isaac, that speaks volumes, right? You don't want to be that person that the Bible verse talks about. Even if you're mostly good, but a small fleshly issue. Isaac, he was doubting. So according to the Bible, if you have doubt, you're not supposed to do it. But we live in a society now where things are questionable and we do it anyway. Why? Because it feels good. That's Isaac. It feels good. Even if he doubts, he'll do it. That's the liberal mentality nowadays. The verse is interesting where it says, even though the point is don't do it, they say the word eat. So when you're eating something and then you're like, oh, but it feels so good and I just need to eat this. And then after that, even though you're doubting and that's your safe factor, Isaac sinned. His sin of his fleshly issue now turned into another one, is that he did something questionable. He doubted. He's not supposed to live a life of doubt. He's supposed to live a life of faith. So if you're doubting something, then you're not supposed to do it. Now, returning to our main text here. Now, the transition part is important. Listen, this flesh, can you agree? And if you ever preached or taught, let's be honest, no matter how much you pray up, no matter how much you prepare, we're still going to make mistakes, right?
Yeah,
I can get an amen from the preachers here. Why is that? Because we're in the flesh. And that flesh is so pathetic and weak that no matter how much you have the goodest intentions, the feeling of the flesh will somehow sink in in your spiritual preaching. And then it can't help but come out. Now, one of the worst things you can ever do is that you sink the flesh with something spiritual, especially when you're preaching the word of God. Now, I don't want to put a scare on the preachers here, okay? God is very understanding. He knows that sometimes, even though we don't mean to, and then after we preach, we still make the mistake. Look, as long as there's a reflection there, there's an admission right there, you didn't commit the sin of murder, and generally people will be understanding of you, okay? And mostly they want to see the spiritual side to it, and they'll say, thank you for the sermon. That was a blessing, okay? So don't be hard on yourself. So I don't want you to be all hard on yourself and get scared when you preach. I want you to preach that book with authority, confidence. If you make the mistake, let it come and be humble enough to eat your own crow, okay? And then say, I'm not a big shot after all. Amen. Amen. Okay? Now, aside from that, however, there are those, when they preach, they do it deliberately. They don't put a safeguard. They're not careful. Because no matter how careful you are, the flesh will slip in, right? So then those who aren't careful will naturally let the flesh slip in without them realizing it. And then the preaching that they give, or a prophecy that they give, or a statement that they give from God is mingled in that flesh, and they think it's from God when it's not from God. It's of the devil. It's based off of your flesh. Isaac, notice, based off of his flesh at verse 27, based off my fleshly smell, that this is Esau, I don't care if I doubt what I'm eating. I'm going to do this questionable thing against God based off how my flesh feels. And you know what? Based off of this fleshly feeling, it can be used for the glory of God. After all, doesn't the Lord bless music? So because the Lord blesses music, look at verse 27, because of the field that the Lord has blessed, and doesn't the Lord bless the field? Yeah. So verse 28-29, I will give this wonderful statement from God based off of that fleshly feeling, based off of that fleshly premise. That's the majority of churches nowadays. And that's the most wicked, hellish thing to do. You never, ever want to do that. I'm preaching very strong right here because that's the whole bottom line why you came to this church out of all churches. Think about that. That's the whole reason some people would drive hours to come to this church. That's the whole reason we would make sacrifices. We don't have to do all that if every church got right with God and preached what God told them to do. But now truth is so hard to find. A spiritual thing is so hard to find. And churches have based everything on the flesh nowadays. And those pastors are disgusting to me. And no, I don't apologize for kicking them. Amen. You have ruined people's lives that way. More so than that, their souls. Their souls. Horrible thing to do. And I know you're that second generation Christian. You pastor, you. You fleshly pastor, you. You grew up in a Christian home. But the Christian home was too old-fashioned, right? It's not your grandma's church, as the billboard would say, right? We're in a new generation, so we gotta make it more modernized a bit. Yeah, you're that second-generation Christian. You're a sorry Christian. Verse 30. And it came to pass, as soon as Isaac had made an end of blessing Jacob, and Jacob was yet scarce gone out from the presence of Isaac his father, that Esau his brother came in from his hunting. Okay, I read that whole thing because it's all together. So the idea is, I'll break it down. In verse 30, it just so happened, that's the phrase, and it came to pass means, that's a metaphorical expression for that. As soon as Isaac finished blessing Jacob, and at the same time, Jacob was yet scarcely, so that's like by the skin of your teeth, just like right at that moment, okay? He just left Isaac's, his father's presence. Esau, his brother, came in walking in and finished his hunting. So here is Isaac, and then Esau comes home from hunting. He just finished. And as he walks in, oh, Jacob barely got out, man. Verse 31, and he also made savory meat and brought it unto his father. So Esau also made tasty meat like Jacob Rebekah made. And then he brought it to his dad and said unto his father, let my father arise and eat of his son's venison. So Esau says to his father Isaac, I want my dad to get up. Hey, dad, get up. That's the idea. Let my father arise, eat my venison, eat your son's venison here, so that you can bless me, that thy soul may bless me. Verse 32, and Isaac his father said unto them, who are you? Who art thou? That's why he said, who are you? Now notice how very different that is from Jacob. He's like, are you really Esau? Who art thou, my son? So this one is more different. This is a statement of shock now. Because Isaac has a dreadful feeling. Why? Because he lived his life in question and did it anyways. And then when it bit back to him, his fears and his haunting suspicions was swimming in his mind. That's what happens when you live a questionable life. Because they will haunt you. And then when payday comes, it's going to come down like a shock. And those haunting suspicions you always had because you did something questionable never left you. Even though you try. See, he'll never leave you. There's a lot of good preaching here about a second generation Christian, Isaac. Let's see. So Isaac says, who are you? So he's scared. He's shocked. And he said, I am thy son, thy firstborn Esau. So Esau says, I'm your son, your eldest son Esau, your firstborn. And Isaac trembled very exceedingly and said, so that's self-explanatory. Isaac, he was shaking up very much. That's what very exceedingly means. And then he says, who? Where is he that had taken the venison and brought it to me? See, this is all a statement of shock, haunting suspicions. He's like, where is that guy who already did it for me? He says, who's this who? Where is that guy who took the deer meat, brought it to me, and I have eaten it, and I have eaten of all before thou camest, and have blessed him? The guy who brought me the deer meat, and I ate all of it before you came, and I already blessed him. Where is that guy? Who is that guy? Yea, and he shall be blessed. So yea means truly. It means this will happen. So indeed, he will be blessed. That's the idea. Verse 34, and when Esau heard the words of his father, he cried with a great and exceeding bitter cry. When Esau heard his father's words, he was crying out with a great and exceeding bitter cry. It was a deep cry. It was a large cry. It was a hurtful cry. And said unto his father, bless me, even me also, O my father. Esau's telling Isaac his father, please bless me. Even me also. Include me in this blessing too, Dad. Verse 35, and he said, thy brother came with subtlety and has taken away thy blessing. So Isaac knew. See, he already knew that was Jacob. He knew. He said, who? Where is that guy? No, he knew. He knew. You won't know that it's a sin or not when you do that questionable thing until you pay for it. When you pay for it, you will know. You'll know. Let's keep reading right here. Verse 35, he said, Isaac says, your brother came with craftiness, subtlety, all right, or subtlety, and he took away your blessing, Esau. And he said, is not he rightly named Jacob? So Esau says, his name really is right for him, Jacob. Because remember, Jacob means deceiver, trickster. So Esau, you can tell he's really mad. He's saying he is truly a trickster. His name suits him. That's what Esau says. As we keep reading down, for he has supplanted me these two times. So Esau saying he tricked me these two times now. Supplanted, that's a word, a verb for supplanter. And a supplanter is a trickster. So it's deceiving, tricked. The two times were this one, and then the other time was when he traded in the bowl of chili for his birthright. So obviously that wasn't a trick, it was a trade-off.
Yeah.
Now he fully knew. But when people commit the sin and they're paying for it, they like to blame it on something and say, it was that person who made me do it. Like Eve, the serpent tricked me and I did eat. Esau's case, he knew full well what he was giving up, but he did it anyway. Let's keep reading down. He took away my birthright, and behold, now he hath taken away my blessing. The two times were Jacob took away his birthright, and now, look at this. That's what behold means. Jacob took away my blessing. And he said, hast thou not reserved a blessing for me? Esau begs his father again. This is a really pitiful scene. Look, when people are paying for sin, that's not a time when you're really hard or rebuking them. We do rebuke sin, we do preach hard, but when payday comes, that's not something to say, see, I told you so, and be all hard, actually. Now, look, if you have to say that, you have to say that if the person still didn't learn the lesson, right? But when the person learns the lesson, is reaping it, like Paul said, it's a sad thing. It's not a joyful thing. It's not a, aha, I told you. That's not what it is. Okay, it's a really sad scene going on. It's so pitiful. Esau's begging again. Don't you even have any reservations of one blessing for me? That's what the verse said right there, right? Verse 37, and Isaac answered and said unto Esau, behold, I have made him thy lord, and all his brethren have I given to him for servants, and with corn and wine have I sustained him. So Isaac's answering Esau's request about any reservation of the blessing, and Isaac saying, look, I've made him your lord. That's what, again, the word behold is, right? It's an idea about, hey, look, that's the idea. I made him your superior, so you have to submit to him. Everybody in his family are going to be his servants. I gave them to be Jacob's servants. I've given him sustenance of corn and wine, so all the richness of the land. What can I do now for you, my son? That's the meaning for, and what shall I do now unto thee, my son? Verse 38, man, this is so sad. When you're seeing a person reaping sin, it makes you want to cry, especially if that person's in deep pain and cry. And Esau said unto his father, hast thou but one blessing, my father? He's repeating again. Esau's begging his dad, don't you even have one blessing, my father? Bless me, even me also, my father. Esau's begging him, bless me, even me too, include me, oh my father. And Esau lifted up his voice and wept. So Esau, he raised up his voice. He was raising his voice, and then he cried really loud. Notice that these statements are very, very careful, right? Esau's really trying to search out very carefully right here. Any blessing, one, any reservations, me too, bless me. He's searching really hard. Well, you know, you should have done that a long time ago, Esau, with God's blessing. But no, you didn't care. You just wanted deer meat. You just want a bowl of chili. But now he's reaping it. That's what happens, unfortunately, nowadays with repentance. There is a false repentance where people, they think that once they pay the price of sin, and then they're showing a drama show of tears, that you're forgiven and then you can get restoration of everything. No, that's not how it works. No matter how hard you cry on this altar, that's not what real genuine repentance is. Did you hear me? Mm-hmm. Repentance is not based on tears or a show like that. Go back to Hebrews. This is going to be probably one of the most important lessons today, okay, that I want you to hear. I don't want you to do this kind of altar call. Yeah. Go to Hebrews 12. Now, this is a very scary thing to learn. Let me give you an example. If there's a rapist murderer at court, and then he's putting on this show, and let's not say show, okay? Probably he really means it, okay? But I say really means it lightly, okay? If in this courtroom he's crying and he's saying, I'm so sorry that I did that, please forgive me, I mean, please go light on me, be merciful, I am so sorry. What is going in the victim's family's minds when they see that? Yes. No matter how pretty his words is, no matter how careful that murderer tries to find any mercy or blessing whatsoever in his repentance, it's still nothing but based on a lie. Why? He's only sorry when he got caught. That's the biggest eye-opener. The idea is people repent nowadays when they get caught. That's the problem. No, you're only sorry because you got caught. But if you never got caught, you probably wouldn't have never repented.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
You're only sorry when you get caught. That's your problem right there. Verse 16. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of meat sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected. For he found no place of repentance, so he sought it carefully with tears. The blessing was supposed to go to Esau. That's what Isaac originally intended, but he was rejected. He found no place of repentance, even though he tried to find it carefully with tears. That is a passage fulfillment in Genesis 27 that we read. Now, notice Esau's repentant statement at chapter 27. You can tell that it's not genuine repentance. Yeah. You can tell there's the key thing with repentance, why you think that they're lying and why they only repent when they're caught. It's based on selfishness when they repent. Can I repeat that again? A person repents because they're based off of selfishness, not because they're genuinely sorry, not because they want to make it right, not because that they realize it's a horrible thing. No, because there's an element of selfishness right there. I want a way out. All right, let's look at the signs here. Now, you have to take this lesson very seriously because I want us to take our... I don't want fake repentance. I don't want fake repentance when we surrender our lives to the Lord. Let's look at Genesis 27. Notice right here, the easy thing is in verse 36. 36, during his repentance, he's blaming someone.
Yeah, come on. Yeah.
You notice that?
Yeah.
If you're really repenting, it's not, well, it's because this guy, so I'm so sorry. I was born this way, so I'm sorry. Stop. You're the one at fault, no one else. Number two, in verse 36, it's not really his fault. He was tricked into it. See, genuine repentance is I'm at fault. But right here, he's saying, no, he tricked me into doing that. No, you weren't tricked. You know full well. Repentance, if that murderer knows fully well what he did was wrong, he wouldn't say some statement like that. If Esau knew fully well that I'm the one that gave up that bowl of chili, then the repentance is more sincere. But no, he refuses to acknowledge that. He wants to acknowledge and believe that Jacob what tricked him to giving up that bowl of chili. No, you sinned. Simple. Now, repentance, a lot of people take repentance complicated. It shouldn't be hard. Repentance is simply a change of mind. Now, in an altar call, if there's a change of mind, that should be simple. But the problem is we make it hard. There is no, and another thing, there is no change of mind right here. You didn't really change your mind. You didn't really see yourself as a sinner right here when you're like, well, Jacob's the one that tricked me. I didn't make that mistake where I deliberately made the decision, I take that bowl of chili. So when there's an altar call from the sermon, repentance is simple. God would receive it. I'm not trying to make it hard for you people, but I don't want you people go down based off of who cries the loudest. No, that's not repentance. It's truly a change of mind. You're probably crying out of selfishness. So that you can show that I'm sorry. No, that's tears don't prove the repentance.
Yeah, right.
The change of mind, the definition itself is what it is.
Amen.
All right. Now, when we go to these passages from Esau, we can see that the repentance here is not sincere. As a matter of fact, we really know that his repentance is not sincere because at verse 41, notice he intends to kill Jacob.
Yep.
Why, you sorry rascal, you.
Yeah. Yeah.
If you're at fault, you're not going to think about killing someone after that.
Yeah.
You're not going to get bitter and blame something else. See, he doesn't really see himself as the wrong. He's seeing as something else, some outside factor as the wrong. That's not genuine repentance then. All right, going back. If we were to go to verse 39, Isaac, it's such a pitiful scene. So Isaac, he loves Esau, clearly. So he's trying to give him some sort of blessing. So Isaac gives this blessing. And Isaac, his father, answered and said unto him, so Isaac responds to Esau's request and says, behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth, and of the dew of heaven from above. So Esau, he gets the blessing from Isaac that his living situation is going to be the fatness of the earth. Same thing like Jacob, the dew of heaven from above. So he's going to be rich. If we were to continue down here at verse 40, and by thy sword shalt thou live and shalt serve thy brother.
Yeah,
so Isaac says to Jacob, there's a catch to this blessing, okay?
Right.
Because notice that this blessing, there is some similarities with Jacob, but remember, Isaac cannot give him the same Abrahamic blessing.
Yeah.
You got to remember that.
Yeah. That's right.
But Esau's begging. So Isaac, he's trying to squeeze something of the Abrahamic blessing in there by putting certain conditional factors, some twists to this. Now, one is this. One in verse 39 is this. Notice the difference with the blessing at verse 28. This is very important, 28 and 39. Therefore, God give thee of the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and plenty of corn and wine. That's exactly the same, or is there a small distinction that's similar? Go to verse 39. Let's read it again. Behold, thy dwelling shall be the fatness of the earth and of the dew of heaven from above. Now, I would like for one of you, I know I don't usually do this because I know you're a shy bunch, but funny on camera when you're running around, you're not really that shy. Can someone tell me what's the small distinction here? It's okay to be wrong too. You're just only embarrassing yourself in front of the world, so don't worry. All right. Anyone want to give a statement? Yes. Correct. So God is not mentioned here. That's huge. Isaac was very, very clever. Second generation Christians, they're usually clever. So Isaac somehow squeezed it in there that, okay, you're going to get the blessing, but I can't really say that this is going to be from God. He's trying to appease Esau's feeling. 40 is very clever. He says that Esau's going to have to live by the sword. So he has to go by his own military might for his success, his living success. And shalt serve thy brother. So he has to serve Jacob. He cannot conflict that Abrahamic blessing to Jacob.
Right.
And it shall come to pass when thou shalt have the dominion. It's going to so happen one day when you have the control. See? So Isaac's very clever because he knows that Jacob is not right with God. And somehow there's going to be those moments that God will humble him or his nation. So Isaac says, when Esau, you get the control, the upper hand one day of that, that thou shalt break his yoke from off thy neck. He's going to be able to break off that yoke, that slavery, that yoke of slavery, that servitude from off of Esau's neck. This case is fulfilled at 2 Kings 8. 2 Kings 8. But this is just one passage. There are many times we can see that the Edomites, and even Esau himself, was able to get the upper hand against Jacob. So there are several cases of this. Look at Esau, the country, the nation itself. At 2 Kings 8, verse 20. In his days, Edom revolted from under the hand of Judah and made a king over themselves. So Joram went over to Zair and all the chariots with him, and he rose by night and smote the Edomites which compassed him about, and the captains of the chariots and the people fled into their tents. Go to the book of Genesis again. And I want you to go to chapter 31. Excuse me, not chapter 31. I want you to go to chapter 33. Chapter 33. And verse 3-4. Now look at this. Look what Jacob did. This is something else, okay? Jacob's supposed to be lord over Esau, but look what happened in the future one day. And he passed over before them, so that's Jacob, and bowed himself to the ground 7 times until he came near to his brother, and Esau ran to meet him. He went 7 times to Esau. That's something. Notice how Jacob addresses Esau in verse 8. And he said, what meanest thou by all this drove which I met? And he said, Jacob said, these are to find grace in the sight of my Lord. All right, going back. So there will be moments in Esau's life where he can get the upper hand. That's the idea. During the time of Jacob's weakness. Verse 41 reads, and Esau hated Jacob because of the blessing wherewith his father blessed him. Oh, yeah. So Esau hates Jacob. That's self-explanatory. Because of the blessing where his father blessed Jacob with. That's the idea with wherewith, okay? And Esau said in his heart, okay, bitterness always comes from the heart, okay? The days of mourning for my father are at hand, then will I slay my brother Jacob. So Esau is saying in his heart, one day my dad is going to die. The days of his mourning are coming up. That's what at hand means. It's like really soon. It's imminent. And then that time, I'm going to kill my brother Jacob. And these words of Esau, her elder son, were told to Rebekah. So those words that Esau had in his heart, they were relayed and told to Rebekah. Now, there are several, this is very interesting. 41, Esau said it in his heart, right? So because he said it in his heart, how were those exact words of Rebekah's older son were told to her? That's how I explain verse 42. How do you do that? One is this. One, it could be possible that Rebekah heard it from God. Because remember, God was the one who told Rebekah that one day you're going to have 2 children out of your womb. So it's not too much of a stretch to say that God sometimes would have those one-on-one times with Rebekah. Number two is this. Number two, it could have been relayed through word of mouth. So then, because when you have bitterness in your heart, you can't keep it in there forever. Yep. It's going to come out. So then it's very possible that Esau, after he said these words in his heart, it eventually came out of his mouth. And when it came out of his mouth, Rebekah heard it. Or Esau told it to somebody else, and somebody told that to Rebekah. So it's either or. That's how it could have happened. If we look at verse 42, and she sent and called Jacob, her younger son, and said unto him, behold, thy brother Esau, as touching thee, doth comfort himself, purposing to kill thee. So she sends and calls forth Jacob, her younger son, to her and says to Jacob, look, your brother Esau, concerning you, that's as touching thee means. It's touching. It connects in the context, all right? It's concerning you. That's the idea. Concerning you, he's comforting himself with a deep purpose. I'm going to kill you. That's his only comfort. Now, that's a horrible thing when you live out a life of living off of the flesh and half-baked repentance. That's a horrible life to live. A life of bitterness and a life of bitterness where that's your only comfort. Now, there's a huge sermon that can be preached off of verse 41, 42. My opinion, I could be wrong, but my opinion, the best sermon on bitterness could be verse 41, 42, Esau. Bitterness is so horrible that bitterness comes because there is no genuine repentance. Now, I know that there's many people to blame and outside factors, okay? And it's not really your fault. But you have to realize this. You have to realize that there has to be faith in God, and two, there is something of yourself in the wrong there. If you never put yourself in that picture, you will live a life of bitterness, guaranteed. Now, as a pastor, I went through a lot of suffering in life, and what heals my bitterness is I cannot always blame outside factors or on God. I have to look at myself in the picture, because usually suffering happens even though you're righteous, but it still relates to you. You are the factor. Amen. Because there's something in there God wants to change or to grow.
That's good.
But if there's nothing in there that wants to repent or change, it's going to turn to bitterness. And then when that repentance comes, you don't want a half-baked repentance. Bitter people always have a half-baked repentance, let alone repentance itself. They don't repent at all. So Esau's true colors are pretty much revealed right here. He's not really repentant. He wants to kill Jacob because it's all his fault. It's not Esau's fault. It's all Jacob's fault. Bitterness comes that way, and the most horrible thing you can ever get in bitterness, you know what, I got to write all this down, and let's wrap it up right here, okay? But this is very important. Am I out of bounds?
No, you're good.
Okay. Some things to note on bitterness. I wish I could have done verse by verse here, but I'm just going to go through an expository sermon here, okay? So this wasn't part of my notes, to be honest. But there's a lot of good riches nuggets you can pull up on bitterness here. This is probably the best sermon on that. There might be other passages, but so far what I see, this is really good here. Again, in bitterness, there is hardly repentance here. Two, there is nothing you see on self-reflection. Or changes, right? There's something you have to change yourself, not outside factors or other factors. One thing that was incredibly helpful to me, I'll be a liar if I said I was never bitter, okay? So there was one of those bitter moments, dark moments in my life that I did go through before, so one of those bitter moments, and it was so easy to be very upset at the environment or some people, outside factors, and even God. Unfortunately, I'm not that spiritual, okay? I'm sorry. All right? I try to be, all right? But I'm not, all right? At least the trying part. That's why the Lord will still try to use me. I think that's it. But anyways, when I went through those times, it's inescapable. We try to run away from it, and then you could try drugs. You could try the world, you could try the blame game, you could try moving out to a totally different area, whatever, all right? People think that once they don't come back to church ever again, they can leave the pain behind them. No, it will carry on with you in your heart because it's called bitterness. Bitterness is not left behind at a church building or with the outside factor you blame. It's in your heart. So the most helpful thing that healed me is to heal my own heart. I have to make the change myself. Not the person or the environment. It's me. Even if it's not my fault, not even one bit. Okay? I'm trying to help you with something here when you go through suffering or pain in life. If you make the change yourself, then as long as you're changed, no matter how bad the outside factor is, it has zero, absolutely zero effect on you. Because the one that needs to change, after all, is not outside factors, it's you, see? As long as you're the one that's changed, has the comfort, then you will be healed, okay? Now, the third thing is, in bitterness, your only comfort is bitterness. Bitterness is your comfort. Bitterness does comfort you. You know that? That's why you keep it. Even though you go through sleepless nights, heavy heart, bitter memories and thoughts that constantly pop up 24/7, and the emotions of the flesh run wild, that's still a comfort for you for some weird reason. Sin is supposed to be hurtful, brings pain. But isn't it amazing that we love sin so much that even if it brings us pain, it comforts us. So we keep it. Now, there's one thing I don't understand is that I know that sometimes in God's blessings, it may not be perfect to the way you want. And sometimes it might be painful. But the Holy Spirit truly is your comforter throughout the pain. If you can do that with sin when it gives you pain, and you find comfort with it, I don't understand why you can't do that with God, which is a much better deal.
Right.
All right?
Yeah. That's good, man.
So I hope that, but there's a lot I could say right here, but I will end it right here. I hope that this is going to be very helpful in the future.
Yeah.
Maybe there's someone watching online who probably has that, or maybe sometime in the future it could happen.
Amen.
Okay? God, my Father, I pray that today's preaching have been helpful to the people and will bring glory and honor to your name. Bless the next service in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.